get one of those educated women, make sure she knows how to cook.
I cook pretty good myself. I'll move it. I'm sorry for being late.
All right. We'll let it happen again.
All right. Thank you. The club ladies of Hartford and the fine people in New London, they have a vision. A vision. It's what you call it when you look at a cow pasture and you see a school for ladies. We hauled all the granite from a quarry in Waterford, hacked it right out of the cliffs, and hauled it up this hill here. It's one of the oldest stones and one of the hardest. One of the heaviest, too, as far as I can tell. Hard stones make hard work. That's what you need when you want to make something last. We want this to last.
In the beginning, there was just an idea. A big, audacious idea. Smart girls deserved an education. Not just any education. A world-class liberal arts education that would prepare them to be leaders in any sphere, even though they were still fighting for the right to vote. Next, there was a little city with a big ambition. The city heard they could host the new college if they raised $100,000 by March 1st. They hit the goal and kept on going. Talk about a great beginning. Then there was the industrialist, who went to the bank, took out $1 million and created an endowment. The idea became a place rising on a muddy hilltop. Over the years, it changed and grew, and the big idea grew with it to include new students and to fight other injustices. Today, the big idea has grown up. It's about world-class, worldwide liberal arts education for the best and brightest students, whatever their origins or circumstances. In 2011, we will celebrate the first 100 years. There will be parties and performances and a new song to launch a new century. There will be academic excellence and a new home for the sciences in our oldest building. We will look into our history and see how it has prepared us for the future. We will celebrate our great beginning with everyone who loves Connecticut College and has helped to make it what it is today. We will gather on this hilltop looking toward our second century, and we will set our sights on the next great beginning.
Good morning. Good morning. It's a pleasure to welcome you here today to this, our great beginning of the next century at Connecticut College. Over the next 75 minutes, we are going to show you Connecticut College as you have never seen it before. So sit back and enjoy the presentation. Every one of you today has a unique connection to this institution. From our alumni of the 1930s, I only wish I could look that good at 99 years old. To the members of the class of 2015 who arrived on campus just a couple of weeks ago. Okay. I know you're out there. I'd like to ask the class of 2015 and their families to stand up. These are the newest members of our community, so can we have a round of applause for them? Got the lights. That's great. Whether you've been part of this community for 8 weeks, like our newest students and families, or 80 years, like our alumni of the 1930s, we hope that you will learn something this morning. We hope that you will see your college in a new light and leave here with a new sense of the bright future that lies ahead of us. Just as our founders built our campus buildings, today we continue to build our campus, our curriculum, and our community for the second century, a century in which liberal arts education rises to meet the new challenges and adapts to new circumstances, just as it has been doing for our first 100 years. In today's world, every time you pick up a newspaper or read about news online, we see clearly the challenges that confront our world. The economy, the environment, politics, human rights issues. The problems are daunting. But I've said it before, and I will say it again. This liberal arts education is the best preparation for life and career. Our students and graduates go out into the world with the skills, the knowledge, and most importantly today, the moral compass to take on the hardest problems and to find solutions. Our students and alumni develop a global orientation in the classroom and put it into practice through internships, study abroad, student-faculty research, and importantly, community learning. In our interdisciplinary centers, they learn how to look at the world through multiple and very different perspectives, so important today. Through our CELS career program, they connect their studies with their career and personal goals. They are immersed in a challenging academic program that teaches them not what to think, but how to think. But I know, and all of you know, the excellence of a Connecticut college education is more than any list of features and programs, however comprehensive that it is. What makes this place and this experience so important are the people, the faculty, the staff, the alumni, the parents, the larger New London community, and of course, our students. As a community, we work together to challenge our students in every way while providing them with all of the resources and support they need to meet those challenges and learn from them. Over the course of this centennial year, we have looked back at our history and all the people who gave this institution its start. But today, we are also celebrating the present and the future, and all of you who can help us to build that future, whether you are sitting in this auditorium or are supporting us from afar. I am proud and honored to be president of Connecticut College at this very important milestone in its history. And I am especially honored to be part of this community with all of you as we set our sights on the next great beginning. Thank you. So now, please join me in welcoming the president of our Student Government Association, Dion Essis. Okay, kiddo.
Good morning, everyone. So during the winter of my senior year of high school, my mother took me to the Ivory Coast, and that is a country in West Africa. It's right along the coast. And she took me to this village called Vieille Cloche, which was the village that she grew up in and the village that my grandmother still resides in. We were there to take part in the village's Generation Festival. And this festival is one that celebrates the individuals in that village that reached their 70th years. And in a village like this, those that reach an age that high is something that is done by very few. It takes a lot of financial, physical, and emotional support from families, extended families, and friends in order to ensure growth and development of each of these individuals that lives in these regions. The festival was like nothing that I had ever experienced. I mean, there was music playing for at least 24 hours straight. It was great. At one point, we got to parade my grandmother around in the village on the streets with boom boxes on our shoulders and noisemakers. It was awesome. It's places like my grandmother's village that are responsible for the phrase, "It takes a village to raise a child." That concept plays out in the everyday lives of generations of individuals, families and neighbors who teach, coach, mentor those younger generations, even as the youth are also teaching them. It's a long way from the Ivory Coast to New London, but I found the same kind of community here. As a freshman, I was one of about 15 students in the Science Leaders program. I was excited and honored to be a part of this brand new initiative that the college made to foster science education among women and minorities. And in the 4 years since then, the college has met and exceeded my expectations in terms of developing me as a scientist. I've done research with professors, I've presented at professional conferences, and I went to Vieques, Puerto Rico for Thanksgiving break my freshman year. This past summer, I had an amazing college-funded internship at Mass General. And as a science student, I feel ready to pursue my dream of becoming a cardiothoracic surgeon. But what I did not expect was the extent to which I would develop my leadership experience here. This place, which is kind of like my village, provides me so many opportunities to learn, grow. In my first couple years here, I played lacrosse at the varsity level, and I stepped the Camelbacks. Later, I became involved in student government, and I started working as an intern for the Think Safe Project. And eventually, I was honored to be elected president of the student government by my peers. Each interaction with faculty, students, and staff helps me build on my academic strengths. And now this year, as SGA president, I feel like I can start returning that favor. And I'm doing my best to be helpful, give advice, and encourage interactions to help others make their own way here, as I have. Connecticut College has become my own personal version of my grandmother's village. And I've come to realize that Connecticut College itself has been shaped and transformed by each generation in the past and generations to come. Today, you will get the chance to see that in a new way, starting with my good friend, Christina Balcaron, who is a true star. Thank you.
Thank you, Dion. Astronomy is one of the world's oldest sciences. You can find evidence in it in the ancient Egyptian pyramids and the mysterious Stonehenge. and a fascination with the stars and the planets influenced some of the most advanced civilizations, the Mayans, the Greeks, and the Chinese, for example. And yet, we know so little about the universe beyond our own world. There is so much we still don't understand, so many questions waiting to find an answer. I want to help find those answers. Like the ancient Egyptians, the Mayans, the Greeks, I'm fascinated by the power of the universe and the pull of the unknown. It's a dream that began when I was 5, when I would stare up at the night sky and try to make sense of the stars and the constellations. They seemed so far away for a little girl who had never traveled far beyond the limits of her hometown in New Haven. Growing up, I sometimes wondered if I'd ever get there. Lost in the shuffle of a big public high school, the constellations, the galaxies, the planets, they seemed so far away, farther than they had when I was 5. But the universe, evidence suggests, began with a big bang. The entire universe, as the theory goes, was once a ball of hot, dense gas. Somewhere around 13.7 billion years ago, that ball exploded. The universe was born. It was the beginning, the real beginning, for the stars, the planets, the galaxy, and for eventually you and me. The beginning of endless possibilities. As a senior in high school, I realized I wanted to study science, and I wanted to do it at a place that would pay attention to my needs. I wanted a place where I could make an impact, where the professors knew me by name. Connecticut College was the only campus I visited. And deep down, I knew that I had found my perfect place. As much as I love astronomy, I wasn't always sure that it was exactly what I wanted to do. While exciting questions drew me to the field, there were others that left me very hesitant. Would there be a career for me? Would I be able to keep up? Without the help of Professor Michael Weinstein, the answer might have been no. Freshman year, in his intro physics class, I didn't do so well on my first exam. I might have given up, but Professor Weinstein wasn't ready to give up on me. With his help, his encouragement, and his dedication, I not only passed intro physics, thank God, I began to love it. The universe we now know is expanding at a faster and faster rate. And like the universe, my world is rapidly expanding too. Freshman year, I left the country for the first time to study green fluorescent protein in Vieques, Puerto Rico with Mark Zimmer. That same year, I assisted Professor Arlen Manns in his physics laboratory. In the summer of 2010, I interned with Professor Mohamed Diagne in his photonics lab, learning about the design and fabrication of semiconductors. Things just kept getting bigger. But in science, sometimes the biggest discoveries are the ones we didn't even know about. Scientific research takes a lot of work, a lot of patience, and sometimes a bit of luck. In my junior year, I began to plan for my funded internship through the college's Career Center, better known as CELS. Through CELS, all students have the opportunity to complete a funded internship, and approximately 80% of con students do so. Soon after, I began applying for internships. I was invited to a dinner with the trustees and was introduced to Maria Pellegrini, a woman who works for the Keck Foundation. She asked me about my interests, and I was quick to profess my love in astronomy. She mentioned she had connections at the Keck Observatory in Hawaii. Keck is a world-class observatory. It is home to the world's biggest telescope. The most prominent astronomers that we have here use data from Keck, and even some of them never have the chance to go there and see it in person. And just like that, that little girl who loved to stare at the stars was researching at the Andromeda Galaxy alongside famous astronomers at the foot of the mountain that boasts the world's largest telescope. One of my favorite astronomical mysteries is dark matter. Astronomers have discovered that there's more mass in space than we can see, that there exists this invisible, unexplained mass. We know it is there, we just can't explain what exactly it is. I think the same is true of Con. What makes this place so special is not necessarily the obvious. It's not just the small classes, but the way that the professors truly care about us. It's not about the funded internships, but the people who help you get there. And it's not about the degree. It's about the confidence and the experience you gain along the way. I have learned so much here about science, physics, astronomy, but also about myself. I learned to have confidence in my abilities. I've learned that I can do this, that I can actually make my dreams come true. And now, as a senior, I know that my dreams are within reach. Thank you.
Thanks, Christina, for your inspiring talk. That was really great. I guess I'm, do I animate it? No? Okay, it's on fire now, awesome. So, no, it's so cool, they did this for me, I really appreciate it. So my quick disclaimer, I'm a bioethicist for the Henry Jackson Foundation in the Division of AIDS at the National Institutes of Health. I'm not here in that capacity though, so these are my own views. The government has nothing to say about this. So while there's certainly much more to explore within and beyond our own galaxy, there is of course much to be done to take care of our own planet Earth as we know, especially with regard to our food choices, specifically the overconsumption of animal products. According to the editors of the World Watch Institute, the human appetite for animal flesh is a driving force behind virtually every major category of environmental damage now threatening the human future. Deforestation, erosion, fresh water scarcity, air and water pollution, climate change, biodiversity loss, social justice, the destabilization of communities, and the spread of disease. Relegated to the realm of personal choice, food is generally not considered a moral choice, but I hope you'll realize that our food choices are some of the most significant moral decisions we should be making. While the ethics of what we eat can be exceedingly complex, I will focus on the benefits of moving toward a plant-based diet. Why am I here talking about food? Like many people who find themselves dedicated to a cause, I am passionate about food simply because something profoundly personal as well as social is at stake. Growing up in the dairy state, Wisconsin, I struggled with food choices for my entire childhood. I have two parents who are diabetic, a grandmother with Alzheimer's, and a grandfather who died from his second heart attack. I've also been an athlete since elementary school, and as I worked my way through the challenges of competitive swimming at Conn, my desire to reshape my diet for the sake of performance only grew. Most importantly, my philosophy training at Conn pushed me to rethink what we owe each other, what we owe other sentient beings, and what we owe the planet. So first, the environment. According to the UN FAO's damning report, Livestock's Long Shadow, and a host of other reports, no other industry has a greater impact on the use of our planet and on climate change than animal agriculture. US livestock consume more than 7 times as much grain as the entire American population. According to the UN and many other organizations and scholars, animal agriculture is one of the main culprits in depleting our sources of fresh water. Our oceans, too, are victims of our industrial food practices. 76% of the world fish stocks are fully or overexploited. It can take more than 8 times as much fossil fuel to produce a calorie of meat protein as it does grain protein. 70% of previous forested land in the Amazon is occupied by pastures, and feed crops cover a large part of the remainder. Livestock waste has polluted more than 27,000 miles of rivers and contaminated groundwater in dozens of states. Nutrients in animal waste created a dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico that stretched over 7,700 square miles in the summer of 1999. This is a picture of a swine factory farm. That large black pit is a basically unregulated pit of pig shit. And finally, according to The Lancet, all new infectious diseases of human beings to emerge in the last 20 years have had an animal source. Yes, the main source of antibiotic-resistant bacteria like MRSA and pandemic disease like our modern strains of swine and avian flu, as well as the most destructive pandemic in history, the 1918 Spanish flu, this is a picture from 1918, all come from or are exacerbated by animal agriculture. Animal ethics. Our food choices are also bad for animals, no surprise. In the United States alone, we kill close to 10 billion land animals every year and countless more sea animals. Just to give you an idea of what that means, Jeffrey Teats explains in his 2006 Rolling Stone article, Boss Hog, what Smithfield Foods, America's largest pork producer, has to accomplish to slaughter just 27 million pigs annually. The logistical challenge of processing that many pigs each year is roughly equivalent to butchering and boxing the entire human populations of New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, Houston, Philadelphia, Phoenix, San Antonio, San Diego, Dallas, San Jose, Detroit, Indianapolis, Jacksonville, San Francisco, Columbus, Austin, Memphis, Baltimore, Fort Worth, Charlotte, El Paso, Milwaukee, Seattle, Boston, Denver, Louisville, Washington, D.C., Nashville, Las Vegas, Portland, Oklahoma City, and Tucson. But these animals oftentimes are not just slaughtered. Most of them spend their entire lives confined in factory farms with little to no opportunities for socialization, and mothers are routinely separated from their young, all of which can lead to severe mental stress, even psychosis. Crammed into filthy conditions for their entire lives, many food animals are chronically sick. Pigs are castrated and chickens are de-beaked without painkillers. Male chicks in the egg industry have been thrown away alive or put in wood chippers alive. Baby pigs that are not deemed profitable are thumped in industry parlance, meaning they are whacked against the cement floor until they're dead. Because line speeds are so fast, animals who are not properly stunned or killed during the initial phases of slaughter are oftentimes still conscious while they are drowned, electrocuted, and/or skinned and dismembered. Imagine doing this to your family dog or cat. No major world religion requires the eating of animals. In fact, every major world religion, oftentimes very explicitly in its scripture, supports the compassionate treatment of animals, our bodies, and the planet, and subsequently a plant-based diet. There's also a long line of esteemed thinkers that promotes a plant-based diet, including, for example, Pythagoras, Peter Singer, Tolstoy, Einstein, Martha Nussbaum, the Buddha, the Prophet Muhammad, among many, many others. As many of these thinkers have argued, non-human animals have very significant capacities for pain and suffering, and can even have cognitive capacities that surpass the capacities of human children. It is, therefore, becoming increasingly clear that we do, in fact, have some level of moral obligation to animals. Many of you may be thinking, but humans were meant to eat meat, which is what I used to think. Or meat in moderation is good for you. I also used to think that. But as Dr. William Roberts, editor-in-chief of the American Journal of Cardiology, explains, human beings are not natural carnivores. When we kill animals to eat them, they end up killing us because their flesh, which contains cholesterol and saturated fat, was never intended for human beings. In addition, animal protein increases your body's acid load, which draws calcium from your bones to buffer that acid. And as the Egyptians knew long ago, one quart of what you eat keeps you alive, the other three quarters keeps your doctor alive. So it's no surprise that, that at the very least, five of our top 10 killers are significantly influenced by our food choices. There we go, so the ones in red. There may be others, but those are the clearest connections. While it is clear that heredity does play some role in disease, we have mounting evidence that eating a plant-based diet actually changes the fundamental mechanisms of disease, including gene expression. Even the fairly conservative American Dietetic Association is recognizing the significant benefits of a plant-based diet. Furthermore, several studies show that certain cancers, heart disease, diabetes, and rheumatoid arthritis, among many others, can be arrested and actually reversed, yes, reversed, by switching to a plant-based diet. Those are pictures of some of those studies. They are real. I wanted to show them to you. So a sound, whole foods, plant-based diet should focus on the four food groups: fruits, vegetables, grains, and legumes. With fiber, antioxidants, and many other health-promoting properties, you'll lose weight, feel lighter, your blood flow will improve, you'll get sick less often, you'll have more energy, among many other benefits. Does it sound like changing your diet is too radical? Probably, it did to me. Imagine poisoning your body with chemotherapy, taking drugs for the rest of your life, or having your chest split open for an open heart surgery. The benefits of a plant-based diet are so compelling that many celebrities are going plant-based. We've got Derek Turner from the philosophy department here. I had to put that in there. Gandhi, Paul McCartney, Einstein, John Mackey, the CEO of Whole Foods, Alicia Silverstone, Jason Mraz, Tobey Maguire, right? Brad Pitt, Anthony Kiedis from the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Shania Twain, Michael Franti, Bill Clinton has recently gone vegan and is on the path to reversing his heart disease, which is very impressive. And many athletes are also appreciating the benefits of a plant-based diet, including improved immune function and overall quicker recovery. We got Prince Fielder from the Milwaukee Brewers, that's my hometown. We've got Edwin Moses and Carl Lewis, track stars, David Scott, really famous Ironman triathlete, and Scott Jurek, best ultramarathon runner in the world. Mike Tyson is now vegan, which is hilarious. It is, it's very funny. So given the time constraints, I had to cut down on the meat of my presentation. That was my brother's joke. He told me I could use it. I was gonna say you're welcome to email me, but my email's not in there, so if you wanna stop me and ask me for it, I can give it to you. But I highly recommend reading some or several of these books. The China Study, The Engine 2 Diet is a great kind of starter book to changing your diet. Skinny Bitch and Skinny Bastard are hilarious. Peter Singer's The Way We Eat is amazing. Eating Animals is also good. Food Revolution and Animal Liberation. There are many, many resources out there, so I encourage you to check them out. And don't just read one. There are a lot of nuances to this debate. So I'll leave you with a quote from George Bernard Shaw. The average age of a meat eater is 63. I'm on the verge of 85 and still work as hard as ever. I have lived quite long enough and am trying to die, but I simply cannot do it. A single beef steak would finish me, but I cannot bring myself to swallow it. I am oppressed with a dread of living forever. That is the only disadvantage of vegetarianism. Thank you.
Wait a minute. We have something to discuss here. Our children and youth deserve healthier and more active lifestyles. Eight years ago, Connecticut College students were concerned about emerging data about rising obesity rates and the connected issues of sedentary lifestyles. We talked with concerned New London teachers and school principals. Children were sitting in classrooms. Children were sitting in after-school programs. Children were sitting in front of televisions in the evening. We all agreed, too much sitting around. We discussed how to best examine the issue, asking the questions, how could we integrate more physical activity into the children's daily routines? What are achievable fitness milestones for children and youth? How do we best teach healthy choices and good nutrition? And since literacy is a high priority in this area, can we integrate reading into an initiative? Students studying a broad range of liberal arts disciplines focused their academic and creative lenses on these inquiries. We grappled with the challenges, and out of our research, analysis, and dialogue, we created Project Kids, Books, and Athletics, or as we fondly call it, KBA. KBA is a simple and elegant project with two main goals: increase physical fitness in children and foster a love of reading and learning. Here is how it works. Trained Connecticut College students read multicultural books with children using reading prompts that deepen critical thinking and comprehension skills. They lead 30 minutes of structured physical activities, and they finish with a healthy snack, drinking water, and an interactive discussion about healthy choices. The college students become mentors and role models. They truly inspire the children. At the same time, the children and their teachers and after-school program staff teach our students how to better understand perspectives that are different than their own, and they guide our students in developing basic tenets of a Connecticut college education, including democratic virtues of honesty, empathy, generosity, teamwork, and social responsibility. We rolled out KBA through the college's Office of Volunteers for Community Service with the broad involvement of our athletic department and our community partner, the New London Public Schools. That first year, we trained 10 Connecticut College students in areas of literacy, guided reading techniques, the state's guidelines for physical fitness, FDA standards on nutrition, and we headed out to the Harbor Elementary School. I was there that day. I can still see the joy and laughter on the children's faces and on our college students' faces as well, as they read colorful multicultural stories and as they raced from one end of the gym to the other, trying to better their time with each and every attempt, as they drank fresh water and discussed why water is good and soda is bad. That day was another great beginning for Connecticut College. Word spread, and soon we had requests from many other schools and community-based agencies. Could Project KBA work with us as well? Today, Project KBA trains more than 100 college students each year. KBA teams work with preschool, elementary, and middle school students. Teachers and agency personnel tell us they see new enthusiasm for reading and learning, increased fitness, and improved understanding of healthy choices. Our students report deeper knowledge and understanding of education equity issues, increased abilities to teach, tutor, and work as effective team members. Project KBA advances teaching and learning for all participating, and it is one meaningful way for the college to be involved in its community. 100 years ago, Connecticut College was founded by people who cared deeply about community and learning and believed that colleges could be good local citizens. The founders, including New Londoners, understood the power of an outstanding liberal arts education. It could transform students and it could transform the world. They created a foundation and cultivated a mission that ensured our students have broad opportunities to apply what they learn in the world. They recognize that the experiences of teaching and learning in community could power the very engines of thought and discovery. The founders built in the distinct expectation that Connecticut College students would become thoughtful, engaged citizens. Then and now, our students learn to collaborate and to work with others to make a difference that guides them towards living lives of meaning and purpose. They learn out in the world and bring that learning back into the classrooms. They discuss, analyze, and propose new ways of seeing and doing. Guided by Connecticut College professors, our students' role models and mentors. Throughout the Connecticut College Great Beginnings, students, staff, faculty, alumni connect with local and global communities to unite intellectual inquiry with social and civic action and thereby ensure our students engage in education that matters. Thank you. Project KBA is one small piece of this very powerful teaching and learning community. This community is renewed each and every day by our outstanding faculty. I would like you to meet a few of them now.
When we celebrate 100 years of Connecticut College's history, what we're really celebrating is 100 years of this relationship between faculty and students, the great teaching that goes into it, the incredible student experiences that we build here. That's really what this centennial is all about.
Any student can walk across this campus and have a faculty member know them by name, stop and talk to them. You're really not just a number here. I mean, you really are very well known by your faculty.
It looks like it learned really well.
They're kind of cool, right? See how they're roly-poly?
Yeah.
What I love about teaching science here at Connecticut College is that we're able to do research with students. I think the most valuable thing for students here is that they research with their hands right on the electron microscopes, on the $60,000 microscopes, and working right with the faculty mentors.
It's kind of like you're not taking a dig, but you are.
I want my students to develop a critical perspective when they watch sports. That it's not just the sport, this represents society. Because I always ask students, we have to ask value-free questions.
Obesities link a lot to what?
So my classes are not just an abstract, but sort of a practical. And that hopefully when they become parents or when they become counselors, whatever they become, they can use that in their own lives to, you know, impact other people.
And I think the perspective is a comprehensive sort of web of knowledge that they're trying to weave for themselves in this liberal arts environment.
But this one is a really versatile tool.
The medium that I have, ceramics and sculpture, is a very active, physically demanding medium. And I think the experience of our students here and how I work with them is really quite unique and different than an art conservatory, private art school, or a university.
You will have no lack of data.
Every time I go into the classroom, something fun, something interesting, something helpful happens. Maybe it happens to me, maybe it only happens to one student, but I wouldn't want to differentiate really one moment for another. If you have questions, I can answer questions. I'll stay till the stars come out. We're a highly residential campus, and we want to make sure that we blur the lines between the classroom and the residence halls as much as possible.
You really find more of what we do outside of the classroom, the field trips, the talks in the hallway, the talks in Crow, has just as much impact as the reading and the writing assignments.
The area of music theory that really interests me is music theory pedagogy, how to teach music theory. It's important for me to constantly evaluate how I teach.
A dotted eighth note and 3/16.
My work in the classroom directly impacts my thinking about music theory pedagogy, so I'm constantly practicing the sort of research that I think about all the time.
The students see us as mentors and faculty that we are, but in our field we become colleagues very quickly.
Also, I'm thinking of rounding a little bit here.
The students impact my own choreography and my own teaching when they're the most present, and that's my job. When I can facilitate an environment where they are there, where they're loving to dance, then they teach me. They teach me how to teach, and they allow me to regulate what I want to be in my own choreography.
The book that I am currently editing and just finishing started as a conversation with my students in class.
It's kind of, again, a symbiotic relationship between my helping the student and then them helping me.
I always have these incredibly enthusiastic students that want to learn to balance out what is sometimes the difficulty of the day in and day out of science. But I feel like I'm impacting science by sending scientists off into the world to discover new things, and it's great to see their successes.
The more students flourish, the more their teachers flourish. You can't separate out the students from the faculty once you come into the classroom. It's mutual engagement with common intellectual interests that makes Connecticut College what it is that makes the possibility of excitement ever present.
I think the future of Connecticut College is going to look a lot like its recent history. We're building a place intentionally where faculty and students engage deeply, whether they're in the classroom or outside the classroom, over ideas, over problems, over the whole world of the intellect. And truly, that's where I think the future of the college is.
Hi. Wow, I can't see that video without thinking how, without me even knowing it, some of my professors, Professor Despilatovich, Alan Bradford, George Willauer, and Gerda Taranow helped shape the writer that I would become. Good morning, my name is Stephanie Zadravec. I graduated from Connecticut College in 1990, with a major in theater. Today, I am an award-winning playwright, and I am also the mother of twin 2.5-year-old sons, one of whom has a rare pediatric lung disease called neuroendocrine hyperplasia of infancy, or NEHI. There are only 250 known cases of NEHI, and there is no known cure. There is one treatment, which is that my son Colin is attached to an oxygen tank 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Now, before you think I'm going to completely depress you this morning, I will cut to the chase and tell you that of the rare pediatric lung disease, NEHI is actually a good one. Colin will not die from it, nor will he need a lung transplant. And it is expected that sometime in the next 10 years, he will outgrow the need for supplemental oxygen. So what does it mean to be an emerging playwright and the mother of a child with a serious and rare illness? Well, financially, things are pretty tight. Most days, my hair is sort of shapeless and unflattering. Often, I'm up all night with a very cute boy while the stack of books next to my bed goes unread. My husband and I survived on frozen pizza for the better part of a year, and I gained 15 pounds. It's not that different from college. but that's not the part of my college experience that I came here to talk about. When my parents dropped me off on this gorgeous, pristine campus 26 years ago, I knew two things. The first was that I wanted to act in as many plays as I possibly could on this very stage. And the other was that my mother's bone cancer would likely take her life before I graduated. Both things happened. So how do you have a great beginning when your circumstances aren't so great? When the problems and perils of your classmates seem somewhat trivial? Do you just keep your head down and volunteer for the Saturday night shift in the library? I did that. Do you wear a lot of black and sit in a corner in the dining hall and scowl at people? I did a little of that too. Or do you realize that college is incredibly precious time and try to make the most of it? Eventually, that's the approach that I took, and I came to share five things that I learned in my time that helped me thrive and continue to help me thrive when circumstances aren't perfect. The first is to just show up. That one's kind of easy. Most of the current students here will probably not want to hear this, but when I was a student at Connecticut College, I did not skip a single class. It was really one of the best things I ever did was to just attend every lecture and sit and learn and listen. It continues to serve me in my professional life. And it has taught me that you never know where opportunity and inspiration will come from. Attending every class also helped me earn a 97 in my required math class, which, if you know me, is something of a miracle. The second thing is to find an outlet. Now, for me, that's easy. Theater is a collaborative art form with a built-in emotional outlet. The great plays ask big questions, and it was just such a gift to be able to speak the words of O'Neill and Chekhov and Shakespeare or laugh my way through a rehearsal for Noel Coward and John Guare. The third thing is to build community.
Now, theater people are an odd breed, but they are my tribe. In my time here on this stage, I performed in over 7 plays. I sang with the Schwiffs. I danced in dance concerts. If you asked me today, I could not tell you one line from the play. I couldn't do a dance step. I don't remember the harmonies. But I remember every single person that I worked with, many of whom are still my friends. We still give each other comfort, and our friendships provide an extraordinary context in our lives. Number 4 is to stretch yourself. Actually, 3 of the best classes I ever took at Connecticut College had nothing at all to do with my major field. It was a course in psychology, a creative writing poetry workshop, and a survey modern art history course that I threw into my schedule senior year. In the psychology class, of course, it fostered my interest in human behavior, but it also taught me how to truly question things, how to become a skeptic in a good way. In 1988, I had no dreams of being a writer. I took a poetry class, and my professor encouraged me to submit some of my poems for the English Department Awards. That year, I won the Benjamin T. Marshall Prize for Poetry. I have never written another poem. But I do like to think that the confidence of that experience was lingering somewhere in the back of my mind when, at the age of 38, I left a fairly successful career as an actor and decided to become a playwright. Why not? As far as art history goes, I thought we were just going to sit in a dark room, memorize a bunch of paintings, memorize the names of a bunch of painters, and instead we were discussing politics and history and religion and pop culture, and suddenly everything I had learned at Connecticut College synthesized, and I was asked to speak with authority from my own point of view. It was extraordinary. The last thing I learned at the end of college is to ask for help. When I was a senior, my fellow theater major and friend Jody Simon wrote a play called No Code. It was a theater outreach piece for her psychology thesis, and she asked me to be in it. She had written the play based on her own experiences with her father's death from cancer, and we performed the play for a bunch of New London high school students, and afterwards there was a talk back where both Jody and I shared our experiences of losing a parent at an early age. After the show, my dean, Dean King, came up and said, "You know, I knew about Jody's father, but why didn't I know that your mother was dying of cancer?" It had never occurred to me that there were resources available to help me, and that I didn't have to work so hard all the time to keep it together. There is always hope, help and hope available to you if you just learn how to ask for it. And that day I did. I didn't have any idea at Connecticut College that the lessons I learned here about art and illness, pain and perseverance would follow me quite so closely in my life. Just this month, I accepted my first large new play commission, and my son Colin was also diagnosed with autism. However, what I learned at Connecticut College is something I keep with me. I remind myself that great beginnings do not have to be perfect beginnings, that struggle is food for the mind and the soul, struggle makes us human, struggle is the stuff of great plays and great literature and great art, and sometimes struggle even gets you a 97 in your math requirement. I know that I'm just one of so many students for whom a Connecticut College education provided a great foundation in all areas of their life. So I'd like to thank you for having me here today.
I'd have to say that my great beginnings at Connecticut College stem from being selected as the first group for science leaders.
At Connecticut College, I've been awarded so many opportunities that wouldn't otherwise get anywhere else, and I'm eternally grateful.
Con allowed me to stay curious about all sorts of subjects and people and cultures and languages.
When I came here, I discovered a whole new medium that I just didn't know existed.
And I joined the Frisbee team, and it's like family, and I've definitely found my place here at Con.
My great beginning at Con was joining the water polo team. It's become a large part of my life.
We competed as the underdogs in Camolympics that our freshman year,
and we actually came in third place.
My great beginning at Conn was my religion and spirit politics class with Professor Kim.
My great Connecticut College beginning was joining the judicial board my freshman year here. I came to visit and I stood on the steps of Blaustein and I could see the ocean and I said, this is pretty cool. I think this is where I want to go to school.
And we found ourselves becoming tour guides, which led to becoming admissions ambassadors.
Well, my great beginning at Connecticut College was joining the women's rugby team.
Me and my class council, we were on the front page of the college website.
I found myself in France for 7 months last year. I never thought that I'd be able to do that.
My great beginning at Conn is still beginning.
One of us, late in the evening, final day of a reunion, let's say someone from the class of 76, midway, give or take a decade in the college's existence, name tag still firmly glued to blouse or blazer, walking back to his room, stops to look over Temple Green and sees the near lights of New London, a buoy or two blinking in the harbor. And behind them, in a pillowy ridge of fog, pushing up from the sound that soon obscures everything below, it's not just one of us standing here, but 100 years worth, women mostly, and some men, not as ghosts, but as inklings of what we wanted to become, now retrospective selves. And yet, even as the years amass, a few of us, like this alum with her half-filled glass of reunion-grade Chardonnay, or Malbec, a smear of hors d'oeuvre on his collar, and wadded in her pocket a cocktail napkin with the stencil of the college's seal and blurred motto, wouldn't feel breaking through the ambivalence of return, some deep, abiding, okay, let's say it, love for this place with its now quaint church spire, pseudo-Gothic buildings, absurd and slightly hurricane camel. And whereas they won't need to be in heaven, the trees are labeled, not with names like J.A. Crow and K.B., but the finer parsing of maple, oak, and beech, with their distinctive limbs and leaves shaped with care and planted with an image of what they would become in 20, 30 years or more. And not merely to make the place attractive for perspectives, but to cultivate a metaphor of art, order, and ardor, a working curriculum that mirrors an older notion of liberal arts, with its invitation to consider how an acorn might contain the world and not the other way around, i.e., the world an acorn. Because you've learned the world is only an idea whose value shifts according to the business of the day and politics. But an acorn is always an acorn first, truth and not a whim, i.e., a rose is a rose is a rose, which means the tree's ardor is more interesting than their art and order. That's why we're standing here above the cool May fog, ardor for a place and time, affection for the traced shadows of limbs and mostly blossomed leaves, made from the lighted rooms of Harkness and Freeman, or in the remembered glint of sunlight off Cummings in early evening when possibility and eternity seem the same. Do you remember getting lost in the fog of a thought, in the art of your artful thinking, cramming it into shape late at night, or during a final on Paradise Lost, in which not only did you think you saw the cosmos in Milton's cosmos, but thought, ha, you could describe it. And then you got your grade. Do you remember falling in love with the elegant beauty of an idea? The way Professor Kranz would hold a drawing that looked at one way, you saw a rabbit, but another a duck, and asked you to imagine two faces of Western culture. Not a two-headed creature, not two-faced either, but the faces visible and invisible at the same time. A weird simultaneity that rubbed shoulders with Einstein's relativity and helped you see that you yourself were a fact of invisible visibility. Or Professor Despolatovich's patient fervor explaining praxis as he pushed his daughters on swings. Or Professor Jordan tangling us hopelessly in aesthetics, Collingwood, Pater, Croce, etc., and then inhaling deeply on an ashy cigarette recited on poetry by Miss Marianne Moore, which begins, "You've never forgotten. I too dislike it." Did he really say when he finished, "I'd like to send her a mash note"? I hope he did, because even if you didn't understand much of what he said about aesthetics, like me, you understood his heart and what he loved. And talk about aesthetics. Was that Emeritus Suzanne Langer returning books to Palmer? And with what wonderful, cracked, delicious, ironic, earnest teasing, Professor Taranow might begin a class by peeling off her white gloves while recounting how the night before Hamlet's ghost had come to visit her. Such quiet ardor. She was Sarah Bernhardt's biographer. Or Bob Dolly, the heavyset guy with small ears, belly straining against a white t-shirt, directing his crew to plant the trees we see today. The kind of man, Robert Frost might say, who corrected the world with the black ink of experience rather than the red ink of school. And yet school is where he worked. And what he made schooled us directly in its motto, "Tanquam lignum quod plantatum est, se cursus aquorum." Like a tree planted by rivers of water that bringeth forth its fruit in its season.
Hey, so due to some travel issues, our next presenter is going to be coming to you via the magic of technology live from the West Coast. So, ladies and gentlemen, Tim Armstrong. Oh.
Hi, it's Tim Armstrong, Chairman and CEO of AOL, and very proud graduate of 1993 from Connecticut College. And I wanted to give a big shout out to all the Camel Maniacs who made it back for the 100th anniversary of the school, and a big congratulations to President Higdon and the rest of the staff at the college. Today is a very important day. Unfortunately, I had to travel out to the West Coast for my work at AOL and wasn't going to be able to make it, but I wanted to be there, at least virtually, to share some thoughts on some of the things that I think are really important topics for the future and some of the things that we're working on here at AOL. The topic I wanted to discuss quickly was about civic engagement, and a lot of the civic engagement that I've experienced in my life The start of it and the DNA of it came from Connecticut College. When I was at the school, my father lost his job my freshman year, and I really had to look to the engagement and the civic responsibilities of people at Connecticut College to help me make it through school. And I ended up spending a lot of time in different departments and working my way through college. And I left Connecticut College feeling very strongly that the community aspect for individuals is one of the most important things at the college, but also in the United States. After leaving Connecticut College, I started a newspaper in Boston, which led me into working into the media space and the internet space. I had the fortunate ability to work for Paul Allen, co-founder of Microsoft. I worked for Rick Scott, who's the current governor of Florida. And that led me into working with Larry and Sergey from Google and being one of the first 50 or 100 employees of Google and helping build a global and incredible company through the internet space at Google. A couple years ago, I decided to take the job running AOL. And a big portion of the job decision for me came down to AOL's original DNA, which is about community involvement and the ability for a company to help a community come together around civic engagement. Many people know AOL from its history of connecting people online, but AOL is also one of the first companies to actually put communities together across different segments of the population, and that's something I wanted to recapture when I came to AOL. One of the specific projects at AOL that we're working on is a project called Patch.com, which I co-founded with another employee from AOL. And we're digitizing communities across the country. We go to communities, there's about 18,000 towns in the United States. We're in almost 1,000 of those towns right now where we've gone in and put all the information for schools, business, government, religious institutions online. We put a full-time journalist in each of those communities as well, and we are probably the largest producer of local content in the United States. And the reason we chose to do that is through the economic downturn that's happened across the world, small and local communities have seen a recession in terms of the amount of information they get, and we felt that AOL, because it's part of our DNA, that we could be a company that actually helped the United States grow from putting information and vitality and jobs into local communities. And we go community by community with this product. It's one of the fastest growing products in the online space. We have about 15 million users on the product now every month from zero a year ago. And we feel that from an investment standpoint, the civic engagement in this country, both in terms of the online engagement we're seeing, but also the offline engagement, is going to be one of the most important things that's going to help the United States economy come back and is really going to put strength in local governments and local businesses and in local schools. And when I look back at my experience at Connecticut College, I understand how vibrant and important the local community can be to education, to involvement, and for the ability for local citizens to get involved in activities that will be meaningful for them and for other people within the community. At Connecticut College, I was able to write for the College Voice. I played on the lacrosse team. I did crew for 2 years, and I was also a member of the student government while I was there. And I think really that essence of what I learned at Connecticut College is what we're trying to bring to every town in America. And I would be very proud of AOL, of all the people we work with, the 5,000 employees at the company, and our ability to take that DNA of civic engagement and engagement around local communities and help the country grow, help our business grow, help our customers grow, and most importantly, have every citizen in this country have open and fair access to information. So when you think about the 100th anniversary of Connecticut College, and you think about what that community has done for thousands of graduates and thousands of people in the New London community, all of you and all of us have that ability to do that across every community across the globe, and we're doing one small part of it, but I hope all the graduates of Connecticut College and the current students there take the opportunities you have in terms of the changing digital age and in terms of the civic engagement the country needs right now, and you go for it. I've had a great experience being a graduate. I've been a trustee at Connecticut College, and I'm looking forward to staying involved for years to come. So enjoy the weekend. Go Camels, and I hope the teams won all their games today.
Hi there. I'm going to stand over here just in case Tim comes back. I'm going to frightened me a little bit. So I was sitting in my office at one of my restaurants, and I got a phone call from someone I respect greatly, a guy named John Fullerton. I consider one of the smartest people I know, and he was coming to dinner, and he wanted to see me. He wanted to come by the office before and just sort of last minute. And I said, sure, come on up. And he came into the office, and I've known him for years, and it was like his hair was on fire. And he threw this piece of paper on my desk, and he said, this may be the most important graph on planet Earth. And I thought, okay, why? And he said, because it accurately defines the problem. And I gotta go eat, but you should look at it. So off he went. And so I was a economics major at Conn during my time. I should say I was a macroeconomics major and a microeconomics survivor. I was somewhat dyslexic, and I loved information visually and always loved graphs. So, you know, I jumped right on this. The first thing that hit me was, oh God, there it is again, sustainability. You know, the word is getting thrown around an awful lot lately to us. To those of us in the food movement, sustainability is in a very similar place to where organics was a few years ago, 15 years ago. And today we have the organic frozen TV dinner, and the organic Twinkie is coming soon. And, you know, sustainability is in a dangerous place because it's being attached to all kinds of things, and it's very difficult to define. Difficult because the metrics when you're talking about sustainability, depending on the subject matter, vary greatly. And unless you can get some kind of a global definition for it, you're not really talking about anything. I mean, we don't know that what we're practicing at our farm is actually sustainable agriculture. We think it's better than what's been going on, and that's actually not that difficult. But sustainable, we don't know. In my humble and very naive opinion in some respects, maybe as close to defining it in a global sense as I've seen. It comes from an economist, ironically. They're not generally that good at the sustainability area. There's a Belgian economist. But what's really interesting is that in doing his research and coming up with this theory, he sought out a group of biologists and anthropologists, mostly in Maryland. And he examined the theory of sort of a global sustainability approach based on what makes ecosystems work. Why are ecosystems a good source and why was that a smart decision on his part? Because ecosystems have been around for millions of years. If they are there for us to study at this point, it's a reasonable assumption for us to make that they are sustainable. They've made it this far. If we can copy what they're doing, then you know, we're on the right track. And it turns out that these scientists in Maryland basically boiled it down to two metrics, which were the unusual part of this graph when I looked at it, efficiency and resiliency. So in ecosystems, efficiency is essentially throughput, right? That's biomass quantity for a simple definition. How much is going through the system? Resiliency is adaptability and the ability for those systems to survive over time. And the argument is, if you could raise this bottom line up a little bit and sort of put a triangle in the middle like a seesaw, the idea is to balance efficiency against resiliency. And it turns out that sustainability has a pretty narrow range. That box at the top that talks about the optimum range, you tip it a little bit towards resiliency, or I would say even more towards resiliency is probably better, you're still okay, but then the drop-off's quick. If you go in the other direction towards efficiency, you get problems very, very fast. So for food systems, and I would argue for many of our cultural systems, which end of the scale do you think we've been educating our young people and generations to focus on? Anyone? Right, we are way over here. Okay, so we're right at the bottom of the scale, and sustainability's got a serious problem. How do you balance the scale? How do you put emphasis back on resiliency to tip our chances back in a better direction? And I want to touch on, and I will in a minute, some of the things that President Higdon said earlier, some of the things that Deanne talked about and Sam, because they're all relevant to this idea of the value of a liberal arts education. The experts, God bless them all, the MIT people and the geniuses of the year, they are efficiency trained. They are one-minded focus. It's very efficient. It's very productive in a certain sense. It's also very dangerous as we move forward. So I wanted to look at a fellow board member of mine this morning looked at this, sort of saw it in passing as I was trying to get it ready, and he said, nice org chart. And yeah, it's a mouthful. But this is not a new place. Sivano is a little community outside of Tucson. It was founded with state money and local government support. It's about 800 acres, and it was meant to be a community of the future. And to be successful with this problem, we need to look at creating communities that tackle the issue on all of those metrics. So if you look at Sivano on that scale of whether it's being resilient and efficient, at the same time, they're one of the more interesting examples out there. And I'm not going to spend the time to delve into any of them. You can sort of look at some of these points and certainly follow up with me later. But one of the really interesting ones they do is they restrict the investment of capital. Because of the buzz around it, more recent buzz, there's a lot of people who want to get involved. And they very tightly control with the boxes in the outside circles, how resources are deployed and how each of those resources affect the things that they care about in the middle of their community. Now, you know, you can attack them for being Marxist, but they're not. It's not what it's about. It's about recognizing that there is a balance and that there is an interdependency and an interconnectivity and a diversity in their community that is what they have stated they want to do and what they want to be about for the future. This is the place that I work, equally confusing graph. And it's a farm, but primarily it was built as an education center. So it has some relevance to Connecticut College, and I want to get to the college last. The education center sits in the middle of a working farm. We raise animals, and we do eat them, and vegetables. All respect to Sam, we do. No beef, but we do have lots of animals there. And we raise vegetables, and we have a very active compost operation, sort of feeding the system. And the restaurant, which is my business, is an integral part of this because we buy most of what the farm produces. The education center's job, essentially, is to sit in the middle of this and figure out what's interesting about what's going on around the windows and create public programming that draws the public to the place. The components, and we were not geniuses when we set this up in sort of knowing all of the implications, but the idea was to work with nature in the construction of a farm and in the practice of agriculture, as opposed to trying to control nature. 99.95% of the agriculture on this planet is run with the notion of trying to somehow control nature. What we were trying to do was fit into our ecosystem. So back to that original slide real quick, we were trying to balance in that little optimum range that allows us to operate and not be the enemy of conservationists, for example, who believe that agriculture, you know, is destroying what greenland is left and turning pastures is not the way to go. But we do have to feed people. So what are the systems that are going to help us do that? And this is an attempt on the farming level to try and create those balances. But there are more components to it that start to resemble a community. I use community a little loosely. No one actually lives here, although I do end up sleeping there often. There is a community of visitors. There is a community of about 100 employees between the restaurant and farm and education staff. And there's a community now of over 100,000 visitors that come to the place every year. So it's a very vibrant community, not unlike Con on a busy Saturday. And what is interesting is that the structure that has emerged here is one where we have recognized that our success is dependent on the success of the other attributes of the farm. And we can't succeed if they don't. And things that may seem like opportunities for us to be efficient, when weighed against the cost that it will have on one of our fellow contributors, it doesn't look worth it at all. And we spend an awful lot of time sitting around in a circle debating these issues and trying to reach consensus on it. And one other interesting anecdote, it goes beyond the circles that are here because the customers have had to get involved, like it or not, in this process. One of the things we found was that to support the farming that we want to be doing, the farmers can't take our order as a restaurant or as a public that enjoys the public market there. They can't be growing what people say they want to eat. They need to be growing things that are good for the soil, that are good for the ecoculture of that property. We, as the primary tenant, need to agree to buy it. And for economic reasons, we need to agree to buy all of it. And if we're doing that, then we can't offer you, if you're a customer and you come visit us, any real choices. So there are no menus anymore. We took those away. And you know, some people come in and get very angry about that. Most of them get a good discussion with Maddie, our reservationist, on the phone, so they know what to expect. When they come and they weren't expecting it, it can get tricky. But we just don't have them. We can't have people ordering and feeling like what they're going to eat. They need to come there because they feel like eating what the farm has provided that day. And that's a system, again, that for the long term switches food, as an example, from sort of a demand-driven thought to a supply-driven thought, like what is the earth willing to give us, right, to survive. So now, I want to quickly go on to Con. Here's another interesting, confusing graph. My little vision of Connecticut College, actually not mine. There's a lot of people who shared in developing this. But if you look at Con as a community, as a sustainable organization, it's been here 100 years, it has an incredibly bright future. The components that make this college run, sort of the keepers of the flame, I would put those in the outside circle, and all of the initiatives that they engage in the middle, with the goal of supplying a superior liberal arts education to students, is very much about that balance between how to do it efficiently and how to do it resiliently. And I will tell you on the future side, from an entrepreneurial standpoint or from a community activist standpoint, we need this kind of thinking. We need these kind of micro communities to help solve problems and attack problems in a way that we can rely on. The efficiency model, you are seeing the byproducts of it in ever greater numbers and with ever greater impacts. And if we rely on that type of thinking, which I think a lot of these institutions produce, I'm trying to think of byproducts that would be relevant, you know, the levees in New Orleans, the blackouts that you experienced up here a few years ago, the financial crisis of a couple of years ago. That's efficiency at work, right? I mean, those are assumptions and models that just are not resilient to sudden changes. And we can't afford to have those inevitably with the stakes going up each time. We need thinking that balances that. So for those of you who are pushing the more common sustainability initiatives at Con, and I've heard over this weekend discussions of the geothermal aspects of the new science building, getting rid of bottled water and the evil Chiquita banana, I applaud all of that. I think it's really great work, and it's not to be underestimated. But the big picture of Con in the context of real sustainability is not new. It has been built very carefully over 100 years, and it is getting stronger. And it is an incredibly important and unique part of this school. And all you really need to do, I mean, you can certainly contribute to it, but all you really need to do to get at it is to, you know, focus your lens and look at the community in that way. In that sense, it's very low-hanging fruit, and you should eat it and enjoy it. Thank you.
So, as we've learned here today, each one of us has played some role, big or small, in making Connecticut College what it is today. I believe that together we are celebrating all that we have helped Connecticut College become, and together we are building for the college's future. And each and every one of you in this room here today will help shape Connecticut College for the next century.